A Politico news article reveals that the US administration plans to place a nuclear reactor on the moon's surface by 2030. An anonymous senior NASA official stated, "It's about winning the second space race." You may be thinking why. There is nothing on the surface of the moon that requires a nuclear reactor. Shouldn't we be working on establishing a lunar base first? Well, the reason this is happening is not to do with space policy directly, but to do with geopolitics. China is leading a rival organization to the Artemis program that is planning on an international lunar research station at the South Pole, complete with a megawatt-class nuclear power plant. Another crucial factor is the Outer Space Treaty, which prohibits countries from claiming ownership of celestial bodies. So, how can the US protect vital assets such as key locations with lunar water ice, vital for sustaining a lunar presence, from adversaries if it can't own land on the moon? Well, you could always establish a safety zone. If that safety zone just so happens to include vital lunar resources, by say being established right next to Shackleton Crater, then you can exclude non-Artemis signatories from accessing those regions, you know, for safety. So this explains why no existing infrastructure on the moon is necessary. NASA stands to gain massively from this power station, even if geopolitics underpins the motives. After all, the entire Apollo program was about geopolitics. It still resulted in huge leaps in technology and scientific knowledge about the moon, while inspiring a whole generation of young Americans to go into science and technology fields. Getting back to the Politico article, it calls for industry proposals on a 100 kilowatt nuclear reactor ready for launch by 2030. While the article offers limited details, a recent paper by Myers and Lal, titled "Weighing the Future, Strategic Options for US Space Nuclear Leadership," provides much more information. This video will use this paper to explore the implications of a lunar nuclear power plant, including its benefits for Artemis missions and a potential South Pole base. While the paper covers nuclear for propulsion, the paper makes it clear that the focus should be on power, not transportation. I'll cover nuclear propulsion technology in a follow-up video, as there is a lot to explain and various options with trade-offs to explore. In the paper, Myers and Lal call for the rapid development of a space nuclear power system. The goal is to have a system ready for ground tests in 2028 and a system deployed on the moon's surface by 2030. We found that if we need to make progress in space nuclear, we need to begin with a small, manageable system on a timeline that keeps stakeholder interest, Lal said. NASA's interim leader, Sean Duffy, who also heads the Department of Transportation, serves as acting administrator. He has been given the goals of quickly replacing the International Space Station and now building and deploying a nuclear reactor on the moon. The directive will require NASA to designate a leader for this program and to get industry input within 60 days. With China potentially placing boots on the moon by 2030, NASA must act urgently to maintain its leadership in space exploration. The Strategic Options for US Space Nuclear Leadership Report by Dr. Bhavya Lal and Dr. Roger Myers. The Idaho National Laboratory funded their paper on behalf of the US Department of Energy. Both authors are experts in nuclear power, and Dr. Lal previously served as NASA's chief technologist. The paper addresses the chicken and egg problem in nuclear power development. Without mission pull, meaning missions assume nuclear power is not available, so design their systems without it. Since nuclear power is not required for any missions, it's not developed. Another issue is no test stands exist for nuclear testing without a funded program. Since there are no funded programs, no test stands are built. In short, potential users of nuclear power won't commit without knowing for sure that a nuclear power plant is available. This problem can't be solved without government intervention. Lunar exploration would gain directly from a modest nuclear surface reactor, ranging from 10 to 100 kilowatts. As the base expands and lunar resource harvesting begins, a larger reactor between 100 and 500 kilowatts would become essential. Such a system would also suit missions like near-Earth asteroid prospecting and mining. the most powerful systems generating 500 to 2,000 kilowatts, prove vital for a sustained Mars presence and commercial-scale lunar resource harvesting. A first-generation nuclear power plant, ideal for initial lunar surveys, prospecting, scientific missions, and small-scale habitation, is a starting point for using a surface nuclear fission reactor. Building on this initial reactor design, engineers could create and deploy higher power surface reactors. These improved designs would pave the way for nuclear electric propulsion and in-space nuclear reactors to provide additional power to national security payloads and satellites, allowing these assets to include advanced AI systems and power-hungry sensors or equipment. Power first. The paper proposes a strategy of adopting nuclear for power first with nuclear-powered propulsion later. The applications for surface power are more near-term. No crewed missions for Mars are planned by NASA yet, while the Artemis base camp is scheduled for less than 10 years from now. Power is technically easier than transportation, plus power will help enable propulsion, so it's the obvious choice to make. The authors say that prioritizing power doesn't mean abandoning transportation, it's about getting the order right. Power is needed now by real customers and builds the foundation for everything else. How soon will nuclear surface power reactors be available? The authors suggest it's doable to set a goal of 2030 for the first nuclear surface reactor. Right now, a tiny 1 to 10 kilowatt reactor can be built. With some funding and the necessary focus, a larger 10 to 100 kilowatt reactor could be deployed to the moon's surface. However, the authors doubt that a large 100 to 500 kilowatt reactor could reach the moon by 2030. They conclude by saying that a fast demo beats a flawless fantasy. Power comes first. No juice, no journey. Power is a launch pad for everything. If the stars align, go big. If not, play chess, not roulette. Keep flexible. Pivot to available launches and lander tech, not architectures. Payload should prove the point of nuclear, not become the point. Before we get into the proposed options, let's look at why there is such urgency in developing and deploying nuclear power plants on the moon. The competition. China is planning the construction of the International Lunar Research Station along with its partners. China is moving fast, aiming for boots on the ground as early as 2030. By 2035, with the help of Russia, they expect to deploy a megawatt-class nuclear power plant near the moon's south pole. If that happens, they can justify placing an exclusion zone around the plant, potentially denying access to valuable lunar resources to NASA and its partners. To understand how quickly China is capable of moving, the Tiangong space station project started in 2010, with a design freeze in 2015. It was declared fully operational in 2022, so from design freeze to operational readiness in 7 years, with assembly completed in 18 months. China has a track record of executing quickly in space. Their space station went from a design to fully functioning in a matter of years. It would be foolish to think their execution would be any slower on the moon. Okay, let's examine the three options the study proposes. Option 1, go big or go home. The option is recommended when there is strong consensus on funding the nuclear program. This requires stable, multi-year funding and robust, centralized leadership with authority over milestones. This nuclear power system is capable of producing between 100 to 500 kilowatts of power, which is enough to power a future nuclear electric propulsion engine. This would be a government-led effort with a potential cost of $3 billion. This option is transformational, but requires exceptional alignment between the executive branch, Congress, and industry. Dr. Lal compared it to the Manhattan Project. Option 2, Chessmaster's Gambit. This option funds multiple public-private partnerships for smaller systems of between 10 and 100 kilowatts. NASA would not specify the design, leaving commercial entities to innovate on their own. Fixed-price, milestone-based contracts, the same as the cargo and crewed missions for the International Space Station. The authors advocate two tracks. NASA leads the first, which concentrates on designing and deploying a surface reactor for lunar missions, with scalability for Mars later. The Defense Department handles the second track, developing a nuclear reactor for in-space applications, Each track carries an estimated cost of $1 billion. Option 2 is the more executable pathway, grounded in near-term missions and existing agency strengths. In either scenario, staying on schedule is key. Dr. Lal says, a 2028 ground test and a 2030 flight aligned with budget cycles, agency leadership terms, and congressional expectations. Miss it and we risk stakeholders walking, funding drying up, and competitors defining the future without us, unquote. Option 3, light the path. The third option operates alongside either option 1 or 2, serving as an inexpensive hedge against challenges in those higher risk, higher reward approaches. It focuses on developing new commercial RTGs, or radioisotope thermoelectric generators. NASA has long used these systems to generate power for missions where solar was not an option. The initiative would introduce new suppliers and investigate alternative isotopes, such as americium-241 and strontium-90. I've covered this topic in my video on Xenopower, a space startup developing nuclear batteries using strontium-90. Check out that video for the details. Space startups like Xenopower favor strontium-90 as a cheaper and more abundant alternative to plutonium-238, which NASA uses for its Mars landers and outer planet missions. Experts view americium-241 as worth investigating due to its exceptionally long half-life of 432 years, which ensures stable power over long periods of time. Option 3 is low-hanging fruit, Lal said. It buys time, credibility, and momentum no matter what, and it provides a fallback if larger efforts slip. Unquote. Either scenario is not an end in and of itself, Lal said, but a step towards greater capabilities down the road. Enduring presence on the Moon and Mars, propulsion to Mars, nuclear tugs in Earth orbit, power for peace and projection in contested regimes. We spent 60 years circling the problem. The pieces are finally in shape, she concluded. What we need now is resolve. Unquote. Nuclear surface fission reactors, runners and riders. Several US companies stand ready to design and build nuclear fission reactors capable of operating on the Moon's surface by 2030. Lockheed Martin has already designed a nuclear fission reactor for the Moon. Their work targets a 40 kilowatt reactor that is deployable in the 2030s, making this company well positioned to bid for a commercial contract from NASA. Westinghouse would likely submit a bid as well. The firm specializes in nuclear reactor design and has secured funding from both NASA and the Department of Energy for lunar reactor concepts. Intuitive Machines, as part of a joint venture with X Energy, designed a nuclear reactor for the Moon. L3Harris is well positioned to bid, and they have already worked on nuclear reactor designs for NASA's Artemis program. Rolls-Royce have designed a microreactor for the Moon, with funding for lunar surface nuclear power development from the UK Space Agency. They plan to have a reactor ready for deployment on the Moon in the 2030s. And Antares Industries, a space startup I've covered on this channel, is developing micro-sized reactors for the Moon and Mars. Their designs are scalable, producing between 100 to 500 kilowatts. They formed a partnership with X Labs for nuclear-powered satellites and space tugs for missions to the Moon, Mars, and asteroids. Final thoughts. We will have to wait for the official announcement before we get dates for demonstrations and flights. Antares is working on a tech demo of a nuclear-powered spacecraft with Exolabs. It will be a geostationary orbit mission scheduled for late 2028 or 2029. In addition, Antares is preparing for its first fuel demonstration in 2027 while building a factory to support rapid hardware building and testing, likely for Earth-based systems initially. What option would you choose? Option 1, go big or go home, massive funding for large nuclear reactor. Or option 2, Chessmaster's Gambit, multiple contracts with private companies to deploy a smaller reactor on the Moon by 2030. Share your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week, or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I've received, along with late-breaking space news and previews of upcoming content. If you got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.